Hello boys and girls. In this video I am actually for a change doing some physics. Since in previous videos I talked for 2 hours or so on the quaternions and the rotation group come up and other Lie groups. Today I'm going to discuss the example in physics, the most natural example maybe, of some Lie group configuration space that is different than just the normal Euclidean space, let's say in three dimension. And namely, we're going to talk about a rigid body. So for example, I have here this candle, and we may think of it as some mass density in this area. And of course, if we like, let's say adopt the Newtonian model for this world, we think of that as a bunch of points held together by some inner forces that we are not going to discuss. We are not going to contemplate why this is a rigid body. We are just seeing it as a bunch of points that are held together in one place. And if I move the object, then I move all of the points in this object in a coherent kind of fashion. Rigid just means that the individual distances between points inside of this body, right? This is a bunch of wax, and there are, let's say, some fixed wax molecules, and the orientation and distances between them are fixed even if I move the body around. Okay, so I guess, you know, I have some more objects. All of these things are objects. Here's another object, this bottle. I'm going to use these two as examples. The first thing to note is that we kind of easily guess the configuration space of these objects, or of objects in space in general. By configuration space, I mean the space of parameters to describe their configuration, the situation in which they are in. So in this case, the position that they take in the world in some fixed reference frame, let's say, you know, with in the reference frame of this microphone or so. It's a fixed reference frame. We can have some coordinates with respect to this microphone. All of the objects in the space have some point in at each point in time, some coordinate. And then the question is, how do I describe the configuration of this object? And well, as a matter of fact, this is just the three-dimensional space, so the Euclidean space, or R3 if you want, times the Cartesian product with SUO3. So there is the position, and then three more coordinates, and these three coordinates give you the orientation of the thing. So, you know, if I move this thing around, I change the coordinate in this three-dimensional space. This is already true for a point particle, right? If you learn, like, the way the Newtonian laws are formulated, they are formulated for point particles. It's all about actions at points. And whenever you have a more complicated situation, then you have to use the laws for all the points, and then you get the integrated law for whatever object. But since this is an extended object, it doesn't suffice to just state one point in three-dimensional space, which would be the position. I have also stated the orientation, right? All these, like, I go through various orientations with time now. All these orientations I want to capture with these three parameters, and that would be angles. So what you can do is you choose a coordinate system and basically a zero orientation. Let's say in some coordinate system here, this would be the zero orientation. And then, you know, I might fix a point, let's say like this point here, and rotate this object around this point. The position of the point, this point here, stays fixed, but the orientation changes. And I mean, since I don't have the a whiteboard in this situation, I won't go in too many details, but essentially you would basically just need a three-dimensional vector to describe the orientation, and the direction of this vector would correspond to the axis of rotation relative to the starting position. So if this is the starting one and this is the orientation that you want to describe, then you can put some axis in the space, which is the axis of rotation around this point. The axis might lie here somewhere, and then the magnitude of the vector would be the angle, which just goes from 0 to 2 pi. So that's why it's topologically not R3, it's something more compact, no pun intended. And so these are the same sort of parameters as you have in, like, the topology of things is as you have it with SO3, and the Lie group action on this configuration space on itself, rotating the orientation axis enables you to move along in this space and turn things around. So to describe this object, you state the position and an orientation relative to some basic orientation. Okay, and so the question that we are going to discuss in this video, might be an hour or so, I'm afraid, is what do Newton's laws, as formulated for force acting on all the points, and the whole standard machinery that is usually developed around it, right? You speak of in the simplest models of point particles, and then you derive statements regarding the force and kinetic energy, potential energy. How does this translate to extended bodies like that, which are described by some mass density at some point, and then some movement around in the world? How do I formulate the kinetic energy, which evidently, like, the kinetic energy really must be describable in terms of the mass density of this thing and the velocity of this object? But what is the velocity of this sort of object, right? If I make this kind of motion, right, then different points on this object have different kind of velocity. For example, if I do this kind of motion, then points here are more or less stable, right, in this kind of motion, but points here are moving. The further they are to the bottom, the more they move. This doesn't move, this moves a lot, and so it's a little bit more complicated. Different when I do just one movement through the six-dimensional configuration space, I carry along all of the points in this object, which means there are many different velocities involved, right? And the kinetic energy is basically the square of these velocities times the masses. But what does that mean in terms of the configuration space? That's the interesting question that we are going to pose here. What is in terms of the actual configuration space, in terms of only the six values and then the mass density, how can I express objects of interest if they are expressible at all in simple terms? And for things like the kinetic energy, it turns out, yeah, you can actually express all this characteristic objects that you would derive from Newtonian mechanics in terms of a few variables. So this is what this is about. Okay. So I had talked about some of the math we're going to use in this video. So I'm going to assume that you have an idea about cross product and maybe the linear representation of the cross product as a matrix and these kind of things. I'll show you some related Wikipedia pages in a second. Otherwise, it's going to be slow going. So there is this this book that you might want to look at if you're more interested in that. I am mostly familiar with German books as when it comes to physics 101, basically, due to my studies. This is by Scheck Mechanics. I'm not sure. There are certainly translations of Scheck books to other languages and to English in particular. I don't know about the mechanics, but this is, I don't know, this is a 400 pages book or so, and it's modern and it's nicely written, and it discusses the things I'm going to talk about in this video. But after that, it also has a very nice elaboration on the spinning top, which makes heavy use of the momentum tensor, which is the inertial tensor, which we are going to come across at the end of this video. Similar content, although presented quite differently, is found in Arnold's book on methods of classical mechanics. So, as a matter of fact, all these mechanics textbooks, the introductory ones in any case, they all have a very similar structure, in that either they are just doing straightforward, dedicating a lot of time to Newtonian laws and calculations in vector calculus. If they are a little bit more fancier and talk about Hamiltonian formalism and you know, all the good stuff, maybe even you know, expressing things in terms of Poisson manifolds, and as soon as it goes in that direction, the toy examples tend to be the same in this book. So these mechanic books usually have one chapter on vibrations, and then they have one chapter on hopefully on rigid body dynamics, rigid body motion, and then this book, and also the one I just had in my hand, not only do they cover the same things, for example, both of these books cover the spinning top to some extent, but also sort of in the same order, right? So the difference with the Arnold book is that this is more coordinate free than what you would find in this, you know, more straightforward German physics textbook. I recommend both. Both nice books. I have not read, actually. I started reading the Arnold book several times, but today I just went through the library and saw how these books compare. What I should recommend if you want to go in this direction. So, enough of a rant on these two books and the structure of elementary, more or less, physics textbooks. So we are going to talk about rigid body dynamics, but very basic stuff in this video only. There's this more lengthy Wikipedia page. It's probably not too bad. Then there's a dedicated one on the moment of inertia, which is highly related to the tensor we're going to discuss. So I'm going to be focused not too much on this L object, but on this I object. So that's that. Also a long Wikipedia page. There is also, which I'm not going to discuss, the interesting question of, once you have established all these concepts, and as you will see in this video, you can get to them quite straight. Once you have them, you would naturally consider, if you consider a different notion of space-time, such as that in special relativity, where you have four points which are spatially separated, you get easily into issues when it comes to specifying the distance depending on relative motion and motion in general. And then it's the question, to what extent this is actually possible to take the notion of a rigid object where the distances between points in some sense are fixed, and nonetheless have this object move around freely and accelerate. And then there are some you know, notions people thought about how can we introduce that, and they quickly discovered actually that you cannot get very far. So once you're in the setting of special relativity, then the sort of motions that you can get for an object which ought to have constant distances, in that the senses discussed, is limited. So there's this Ehrenfest paradox, and then Born rigidity, and in this Wikipedia article, I think, discusses various notions of trying to capture rigidity, if that's something you want to do. But not going to touch upon this, and just saying that it's interesting to consider. Okay, so all that said, 15 minutes in, motivation is done. Let's get into it. So I've written down three pages as usual. Here I have all these links on my GitHub Gist page, and you can get the text that I wrote down and all the links. Let's go to the start. These first two lines are the quick summary of the thing I talked about in the first 10 motivating minutes. The configuration space, as I hopefully have motivated, is the six-dimensional space, R3, and then SO3, where SO3 is compact space, in that the once you fix your representation of SO3, the parameters don't go to infinity, so they loop over. And like if you're speaking in terms of angles, then after 2 pi or 360 degrees in one direction, one rotation, you come back to. Of course, you know, I talked about this, the way of how to capture the orientation of this object in a 3D space, and I was speaking about one axis of rotation, and then the vector just goes along there, and the magnitude of the vector representing the orientation relative to another orientation. What is maybe I discussed this because we are quickly going to talk about angular velocity, which is exactly naturally represented like that. Angular velocity is like the minimal representation of the velocity of angle change, of orientation change. That's why I talked about it in terms of this rotation axis. But what's actually maybe easier to visualize, especially if you have some hands-on experience with rotation matrices, is if you think of the orientation as like not just this one axis, but you actually think about the like an orthogonal coordinate frame, or orthonormal even, and then express the, like going from one rotation to another one, you know, this orientation change, express this simply as the rotation matrix that does exactly that rotation. And the rotation matrix, of course, like in a three-dimensional space, has 9 parameters. So this is like, there's a lot of redundant information. The possible rotations are parameterized by just the Euler angles, for example, by just 3 parameters. Or, you know, you could also say that the spatial components of a quaternion that is normalized is also a way of capturing the same information. But if you think about the matrices, which people might more easily about the rotation, then it's clear how one rotation matrix represents an orientation, at least with respect to an initial unrotated orientation. Okay, so in that way, it's even easier to think about the configuration as this, because you say, oh, this is the translation vector, the position with respect to some zero, the origin of the coordinate system, and then some rotation matrix which rotates the frame which makes the translation between the frame given by the frame I'm sitting in, whatever this is, the reference frame, and the orientation of this object with respect to some basis sitting, like some frame attached to the object itself. There's some rotation matrix, and so, but this is not, then you're speaking about a free vector and then and 9 components of the rotation matrix, and this might be a little bit misleading given the fact that these this manifold SO3 as a Lie group is only three-dimensional. Okay, since I actually want to get at the kinetic energy formula, which is the conclusion of this video, to get there, I need to say some more about how, on a mathematical level, the different quantities, in particular the velocity, the plane velocity of a trajectory, relates when expressed in different coordinate frames. And just to motivate that, the formula, because I will only coarsely motivate I will state the formula and either you accept that it's true, or you do some handwork yourself, or you consult a book like that. But just to motivate it, I think it's easier believable if you see an analogy in the complex numbers. This is really super short, and that's why I also added this short section here. So what we're going to need for that, and that's why I have here also this Wikipedia page on the unit circle, I'm going to speak about rotating a complex number in the complex plane. To do that, I've also talked about that in the first Quaternion video a month ago or so. If you have here the complex plane, and let's say you consider this point here, right? Then to rotate this point in a complex plane, let's say you want to rotate it from here to there, right? Then what you can do is you multiply the point by a complex number of length, complex metric, complex length 1. And so the multiplication by complex numbers corresponds to a stretching and a rotation. And so here are on the unit circle all the possible rotation matrices, quotes and quotes, like the complex numbers that you need for a rotation. So for example, for a point which lies here, imagine a point there. If I take this complex number which lies here, let's say this is an angle of, what makes sense, 15 degrees. If I take this complex number and multiply it with this complex number, then what happens is this point will get rotated over to this point, right? Because the length of these numbers are all one, so this point doesn't get stretched, it doesn't go out or in, and it's rotated, so it goes over there. And okay, I'm sorry if this is too basic, but I'd rather not alienate anybody. The question then is, in the complex plane, how are these numbers represented? Well, they are e to the power of I and times the angle, right? I'm sure there is, this is the representation of the elements on the complex plane. So this is without an angle, right? So e to the power of, and then some angle, in this case, this choose angle 1, like a rate of progress on the unit circle, times a parameter t. And if the exponent, apart from the I, goes from 0 to pi, you have a full circle, right? Let's define, and it's going to be evident why I do this definition in a second. Let's define a complex number omega, and then another capital W, which is I times omega. Omega is going to be a real number, and we're going to define this complex number U as e to the W t, right? So this object W is, this is anti-symmetric, and an anti-symmetric object in the sense that if I make a complex conjugation here of this object, then I get a minus sign, because this is just a purely imaginary one. And so this actually says e to the I omega t, right? This is actually a number on the unit circle. And if I take the derivative of this u, then it's visually clear what has to happen here. So let's say I have this this, I can take this black point here. But this is one of the points that are parameterized as e to the wt. If I take the derivative of that, then this will move along on a circle. So the derivative at this time is a vector tangential to this circle, right? And so why does the formula say that? Well, this is the vector, the complex number, the vector pointing to this point. If I multiply this by an I, then I flip it 90 degrees to the left. So this is it is something that goes in this direction. And then the omega in my formula tells me how strongly it actually moves in this direction, right? And so the velocity of this e to the I omega is always tangent to this to the circle, tangent to this trajectory, which is in a circle in this case. And that's also, you know, if a psi is another complex number that is being rotated, then the change of this this movement looks like so, where this is a purely imaginary object, an anti-symmetric object. So in this case, I talked about this point here. Let's see, my point here, this was the psi. And I multiplied with this u, this is my complex unit here. And then it will get moved over here. So the velocity is one that goes in this direction down here, right? Okay, so and the w is what makes this, what tells me that this is like tangential to the circle. Okay, I hope this was not too boring or too abstract, but it is just to motivate the formula that comes now. So now we're getting into the reference frame business, right? So the question is this: I have some fixed coordinate frame, right? Before I talked about that my fixed coordinate frame would be like the zero, the static, inertial, like non-moving, not force-free coordinate frame would be, let's say here on my microphone. Imagine there are like three coordinate axes fixed to this microphone here, this point on the microphone. This is my fixed coordinate frame. I'm going to call it O. And the points in the space as seen from this coordinate frame are denoted by the vector, like both letters mean vector, R in this coordinate frame. And now I would, let's start with a point particle. So the tip of my finger here is a point. Let's call it P. And this point moves through space somehow. This is my trajectory. So I do it again. This is my movement. If I look at the velocity along this trajectory, then I have here this velocity vector that goes like this. And at this point, there's a velocity vector going like this. And you know, this is just the derivative of the trajectory, R of P. And so now, if I'm interested actually in the end, in the velocities that are all part of this sort of object, right? This is rigid extended object in three-dimensional space. If I can do this movement, and I made this movement where I not only go along some line which looks like a one-dimensional line, but I also rotate this thing as I go along, right? So it has some very like strange, complicated kind of motion where. For example, points here, when I go like this, might be more or less like static because they move along like so, but they also like turn back. So they are like slower than points here because they are moving over there, but also making this motion. So you know, there's different sorts of velocities all at once in this object. And so if we now consider one point, for example, if you can see this has this black point where the lit the candle some time ago. Let's say this is a particular point B, right? And on the object we define another reference frame which is fixed on it. So let's, you have this point here, and you think about another three-dimensional a coordinate frame attached with the black dot in the center. This is my point B, the black dot where I lit the candle, and then you think a fixed to the candle reference frame also that is attached exactly at this thing. So for this point, the point alone sort of behaves like like all the objects you study when you first encounter Newtonian mechanics. You just describe trajectories as a map from R to R3, from time to the position in time. But now there's a bunch of other points inside of this object. And the move that you make, the trick to be able to describe the kinetic energy as a whole of this object is you simplify the situation by describing the configuration space of some point, for example this black point, the configuration space of just one point, this would be just the three coordinates, the three-dimensional space there. And then you have the possibility that you can, using the coordinate system attached to this black point, speak about all the other points in relation to that, right? And once you have that, to actually tie the whole thing to the space in three-dimensional space in which this object actually moves, you speak about the orientation or orientation change of any point here in relation to the black point which you describe in just three dimensions, right? So what we are interested in is given an inertial frame O and its coordinate system attached to that, and giving a point B and coordinate system attached to that, how do for now our interesting the velocity, for example, relate to each other? And here you have this formula which I'm going to speak about a little. So it says that the velocity of a point P, let's say a point P is some fixed point at the bottom here of the candle. I mean, there's nothing interesting there, but let's say this is a fixed point. I can make a small cut so I remember it. The velocity of this the trajectory, for example, I had this strange kind of motion, would be some motion like this. And how does the velocity, like this vector in time, for velocity for each point in time, how does it look like when I split this velocity in two parts? I describe it as follows. I say the velocity of this point P at the bottom of the candle, I want to describe it with reference to the velocity of this point B of the I don't know what the English word is. In German it's Docht. I just say black point. The velocity of the point P at the bottom is the velocity of the point, the black point, plus something else, right? And this something else is actually given as follows. You take the coordinate description of the bottom point as expressed in the coordinate system of the black point, right? The black point is the one you fixed. From this on, I can describe all the other points, right? Each point from each coordinate system can be described. What I do here is I introduce this the coordinate system of the black point, B, and the claim is here that the velocity of the bottom point in the microphone coordinate system O equals the velocity of the black point in the coordinate system O plus, and then some matrix which depends on the angular velocity, which is the the change of the orientation as expressed with this axis of rotation and magnitude that I talked about at the beginning. Some matrix that is made from that, from this omega, times the coordinate function values of the point P using the coordinate frame that sits on the black point, right? And this W of omega, this is this cross product matrix. So if here they use the letter A, but let's say this is omega, then you construct this cross product matrix like that, and the cross product matrix times some vector, this is exactly the same as if you would apply, if you would take the cross product. I mean, this is just another notation, this is a linear operation, that's why you can represent this as a matrix. So this is the matrix that you get out of that. So you take the omega, which is this vector that has magnitude amounting to the angular velocities, the angular speed, and the direction of this vector, omega 1, omega 2, omega 3, says how this object revolves throughout time. And then you take this, you construct this W matrix. And then this is the way in which you must modify this coordinate values, add it to the motion of that. And then in this way, you can split up the velocity of all these objects here. So we do this, we make this separation so that we have, we are in the end able to describe all the velocities at the same time of this thing, with reference to the velocity of some point. In this case, it's the black point. Later, we're going to pass on to the center of mass because it has some nice algebraic properties. And then we also get the angular velocity in. And the angular velocity, I mean, it might not be obvious completely, but the angular velocity, the vector, the same vector works for all points in any object. So whether or not whether I describe this point P at the bottom or maybe some point in the middle, if I rotate this thing and this is a rigid object, then they are described by the same omega. Okay. Before I discuss this notational remarks that are more interesting if you read this thing anyway, I will talk about this when we get to it anyhow. I want to say that, so again, you can derive this if you think about coordinate systems properly. I don't have a whiteboard and time to write everything down, so I just describe it in this 10 minutes or so. But you can see in some special cases that it's true easily. So for example, if did I write it down here? Yeah, so okay. So if this point, the black point, let me say it like that. If the bottom point, where is it? It's here. If the bottom point on the candle lies on the axis of rotation, right? If the there is some from the black point to the bottom point, if the rotation is like so that I don't know if you see that properly here. So if I have this point fixed, this point fixed, and I revolve it in a way that the axis is exactly around this thing, then even if this object like floats through space, like we are imagining we're in space, there's no forces, this thing floats in one direction. It rotates maybe, but the axis of rotation is going through these two points. Basically, the axis of rotation is moving along with this object. And even though it rotates, it is clear that the movement of the black point and the bottom point is exactly the same, right? If the object lies on the axis of rotation, then even if the object itself revolves around it, if both points lie on this axis, then the points themselves don't move apart from this floating motion through space, right? So by that claim, the velocity of these two points that move parallel through space should be the same. And indeed, this is what the formula is saying. So if this x coordinate, which is the coordinate of the bottom point with respect to the coordinate frame of the black point, if this is parallel to omega, to the axis of like the direction of the axis of rotation, then the cross product is zero, and so this term like cancels out, and this just says, well, then the velocity, the static motion, you know, the static velocity of the point P is the same as the one of the as the black point, so they have the same velocity because they go parallel with each other. So this is the special case where you see that the formula is true. And also, if the base point is at zero, so if the coordinate frame or the microphone and the black coordinate frame would coincide, if this was there, and maybe this object would revolve around the this coordinate frame, but if this term had zero, like would be fixed in space and had zero velocity as a point here, and just the thing would rotate around, then the motion of the point P would be given just by rotation, and then we would actually have the same situation through some plane as in this complex plane, right? And it would just move around the center of origin, and then this and this W matrix would actually be the same. And I mean, apart from being in three dimensions, if you know the two-dimensional representations of complex numbers, then you know that the complex unit is actually 0, minus 1, 1, 0, and that would actually be, for example, you know, you see these representations here. So in this sense, are these cross product matrices the analogy of what makes for the antisymmetry in the complex unit? This is how it kind of comes together. Okay. Yeah. So, you know, I use R for the coordinate in the inertial reference frame O at the microphone. I use X for the coordinates with respect to some point here, so long it was the black point here. And what I'm later going to do is I'm going to use X as a function of coordinates of the inertial reference frame. So for example, if this is my coordinate frame in the candle, and here is a point like 10 centimeters, 10 centimeters, 10 centimeters there, let's say here, then this point in space, like in actual space, this point, of course, also has coordinates from the microphone. There's some, you know, here's maybe minus 5 centimeters, plus 15 centimeters, and so on. So there's a function in which you can then view the coordinate functions of that object X as a function of this coordinate function. So you say, you know, with this coordinate functions R, you search for any point, let's say this, and the return value of this vector field is exactly the coordinate values of the other coordinate frame. So this is basically a general transformation between coordinate frames, or between coordinate function values of objects. So this is what I mean here. I might write XB of RP. So this would be then the free coordinate function values that this point, any point P, has in this coordinate frame, but as a function of the position from the other coordinate frame. Okay. Yeah. Okay. So we're almost there after this lengthy description of my coordinate setup. We're going to quickly talk about the mass density. So I have two rows here. This is the row, backslash row in LaTeX, and this is the backslash var row. Let in a fixed coordinate frame, let's say, the one of the microphone, we speak of the a density of an object, let's say of this candle again, or maybe of this glass here. By specifying how much mass is there at each point, or mass density, actually mass per volume. So here there would be no mass of the candle, and then here in there would be mass of the candle. Let's say this is all the same density, or maybe in the top it's a little bit more denser, there's more mass for some reasons, and the bottom is lighter. It doesn't matter, you have a general mass density there. And then I will also construct a functional out of this mass density. It works like that. If we have any function in the space, you know, any function f mapping from three-dimensional space to a real number, then taking the integral over these two objects is a functional of f. So you can see that as a like f weighted by the mass, maybe averaged by the mass, right? And in particular, this also like already captures the case that is sometimes discussed in classical mechanics setup, where you speak about a rigid body given by three points. You know, if you talk about a rigid body that is extended, then you need at least three points in space. So let's say there's a point, there's a point, there's a point. Let's say, okay, let's say these five points that make for my fingertips. I'm not just talking about these points. I assign these points some masses. Right, some numbers, and they're rigid in the sense that I hold my hand like rigidly, and if I move around, they're also kind of like a rigid body, but this is just given by some five coordinates and not an extended object. And I can also describe this kind of object, this 5-point object, with a mass density by using delta functions if I want. So if I have this Q or some of my 5 points, they have some coordinates with respect to the microphone coordinate frame, and some masses. And then if I plug in this density, then the corresponding density functional looks like that. Okay, this is just a remark that we have captured the full range of nice examples. And so let's finally go to the last section. So what we're now going to do is, you know, in principle, this is a bunch of, you can think of this object as a bunch of points. Like for each point in the candle, which we might express in the coordinate frame, the trajectory of the rigid body make for like infinitely many trajectories of these points of this candle through space, right? Each point has their own trajectory. So again, if this is a point, this one might be a trajectory that is static in space, while the top point makes this kind of motion here. So this has a different sort of trajectory, makes a wilder motion, and so on and so forth. Okay, so the last thing here I introduce is this sort of vector field, where you say instead of like talking about individual trajectories of points as we did before, we now have a velocity field. We're going to use that concept, but it's actually not going to be necessary. It will not actually be a part of our final result, which will be the nice formula for the kinetic energy. But conceptually, it's there. In reality, this is just a tool to get from a point to the corresponding velocity of that mass element at that point. Obviously, if the velocity field only has a finite support, so if the object is moving here, then there's no velocity of any candle points here or there or anywhere. So just where there's mass density, there's also velocity. If the whole thing is moving through space relative to the microphone inertial frame without rotation, then this is on the support of this vector field, just a constant vector field. Okay, and so lastly, I want to get away from the black point and we'll actually talk about the one special point in the object, which is the center of mass. And so as the name suggests, the center of mass is some central point inside of the object. It doesn't actually have to be part of the object, but it's usually, if this is a dense object, what it is the, if you use the mass, the functional, right, that describes the mass density, like so, then if you plug in for f of r just the function r, just the identity, right? So var rho of the identity function, of the identity function, then you basically get the expectation value of the mass, right? And so if now you compute this this expectation value with respect to different points in space, then there's one point, in the object where this expectation value is basically zero. Like, now I described it in terms of mass, the mass density function, but you can actually also see it like this here. So let's say I integrate over all the points. Like, let's say I have here a coordinate frame, here some point exterior to this object here. And the in this coordinate frame, let's call it the S coordinate frame. In the S coordinate frame, all these points have some, you know, positive coordinate function and some mass. And if I integrate the coordinate function values times the mass, then I get some mean point. Like, if we would normalize it, I get some mean point of the a mean coordinate vector for this kind of object, right? So what happens now is that this coordinate, this mean that I just computed, has three coordinates, right? One in z direction, one in x direction, and one in y direction. If I move this object relative to this coordinate frame, for example here, then now it's exactly hovering over my coordinate frame. Then and I integrate over the over this coordinate here, like this coordinate, then some of the points of the mass will lie on the left hand side and some will lie on the right hand side, right? So here are some points, here are some points. If the object sits exactly under this or over this coordinate frame, then if I do this kind of integral, then there will some be on the left, some on the right, and eventually the value of the integral will be zero, simply because I have equally much mass on the left as on the right hand side, right? So if I describe differently, if I have a plane that virtually cuts the object in exactly in half with respect to the masses, there's like some mass on the left hand side, some on the right hand side of this virtual plane, of this virtual cut, then if I integrate with the corresponding component, then I get zero. And I can find this, you know, if I have three orthogonal planes, I can find some cuts of this object where, yeah, if I integrate over everything, all components will be zero, so this is then the center of mass. Okay, was maybe not a good explanation, but it's likely that people have an idea of the center of mass anyway, or have an idea that there can be a point in space which lies in the center relative to all the mass vectors there. Okay, so from now on, you know, I talked about the my reference point inside the object was the black point. Now, from now on, it will be this is center of mass. As a remark, for example, if I take the bottle, which is empty inside, there's just air. If I consider the mass density of this object, of the glass, I can of course still do all these computations and compute the center of mass. And note here that the center of mass will lie somewhere in this in the axis, in the central axis of this object. And because this is a bottle, there's actually no glass in the middle. So the center of mass doesn't have to be part of the object itself. It just has a certain position relative to the, like in the configuration space. Relative to any other point in the object itself. It has some fixed position, but it doesn't. The center of mass doesn't have to be a part of the object itself if the object is hollow like that. Okay, so I think now we have all the ingredients we need for the short computation. So, I previously I had some t's to take the time derivatives. The t's are relevant, of course, but in the next computation in this one line, I will drop them. For convenience, we'll just write just v for the time derivative. So v is, you know, the time derivative of all the points as a coordinate function. And so naturally, what is the kinetic energy of a point? A kinetic energy is just 1/2 times the point mass times the velocity of the point squared, right? 1/2 mv squared. This is what Newton tells us, and therefore the kinetic energy of this fixed object is the same for all points. So you have a mass density, so you have to compute the integral over the mass density of all the velocities here along any trajectory for all the points. So a priori that would be complicated if I would like track all the points and write a simulation. I could of course compute it like that with some grid, some approximation, but it turns out we actually don't have to do that. We can just characterize it in terms of the angular velocity. So the definition of the kinetic energy is 1/2 times the mass times the velocity squared. We have an extended object, so it's an mass density functional over this velocity function, right? The velocity function is I defined it as this velocity of the coordinates of time and the coordinates on the support of this object of the density. So now these are all velocities, and the funny thing is now that we can describe all the velocities inside of this object with this formula that we had up here, and the omega that you have to see it, or believe me that omega is actually the same for all the points in space. So we use this formula. This is going to be the velocity of VP, the black point or the center of mass point, plus this object. This is like a vector squared. We can do now some linear algebra and use the property of this matrix. It is an anti-symmetric matrix taken squared. So there's some rules that you can use for cross products and so on and so forth about the volume spanned by the cross products and whatnot. And out comes this expression. So the VB, this is the fixed trajectory, right? There is nothing to integrate out more because this is like literally just one trajectory. This is just a trajectory of a fixed point. And then what is left here is the mass density of 1. 1 denotes here the constant function that always evaluates to 1. Let me see. This is component wise. The mass density of this the of the of this XB, which depends on the B coordinate system, on the black or the center of mass coordinate system, this object, times the W matrix applied to this constant or this fixed velocity of B. I mean, it's not constant in time, but it's the point is that it's just one value. It doesn't have any coordinate dependence anymore in the space. Here you see basically this is 1/2 something plus something else squared, right? So this is the first thing squared that we had here times 2 times this thing, and since 2 times this is this term, and since there's 1/2, there's no 2 here anymore. And then finally there's this object, which is basically this thing squared, where I have introduced this I, or it should be actually the I at the point P, which is defined as below. And here, I should have written here IB or IC. Like, I flipped around between the black point, between the base point or whatever, and the center of mass system. Let's say we switch now to the center of mass, disregard the BC and think of them as the coordinate system of the center of mass. Then from this object squared, if you also do the algebra, you get this kind of thing. So this is the mass density functional applied to this expression, which depends on B. On the one hand, there's the norm of the coordinates, all the coordinates here from this object, right? XB was the coordinates, coordinate values of the all the points here, or any point here, really. Times in this integral times the mass, and this X was expressed in the reference coordinate system. So maybe my explanation was a little bit confusing, but this is why I have this remark here. I switch a little bit around with the coordinate system, make it correct. And then here, this object is just a matrix that you get by at each point having two of the components. So the 1-3 component of this matrix would be x1 times x3. So this is the tensor product notation here. But in coordinates, this would just be the delta, Kronecker delta, and here would be just the normal product of these components. Okay, and again, we think of this as in the center of mass frame, and the reason is then that this expression here, as I motivated more or less well, this expression is zero actually in the center of mass. The center of mass means exactly that this kind of integral, which depends on the base you choose, is zero, because you have this point that lies exactly in the middle of the masses. So with that, and defining, as seems natural, the just the integral over the mass density as the total mass, we find that the kinetic energy is actually just the normal kinetic energy that you know of, you know, mv squared of the center of mass, the one in the middle here. Like, if I have this trajectory, and even if this thing rotates, the kinetic energy of the whole thing is the normal kinetic energy of the point that is the center of mass, plus some extra term that depends on the angular velocity. The angular velocity was, if we scroll up, just the thing that tells you basically this extra term that comes from the velocity of the points not being in the reference point, in black point or center of mass point. And here, this is the two form. In the middle, there is this IC, and this is the inertia, the tensor, which is the end result of this video. This is the object that I wanted to get at. If you have any mass density and you choose you compute the center of mass point there with respect to the coordinates of the center of mass point. You compute this matrix here, like this is quadratic in the coordinate functions, and then this is exactly the sort of analogy of the mass. If you look at these two terms, right, the first term is the normal mass times velocity, and then here is this inertia matrix, this inertia tensor, which is also a sort of mass times the angular velocity. So the angular velocity, like this point independent vector that tells you how the object moves in space, this is actually the contribution, the energy contribution, the extra energy contribution. And so the interesting thing is that even if there are, like, you know, you might think of this thing as a billion points, or whatever object you think of, whatever rigid object you think of, let's say this book, even though you might think that, oh, this is a complicated system because there are so many points, because of the fact that the configuration space is really three-dimensional, it is clear that the kinetic energy can just be a function of the configuration and the mass, you know, distribution, mass density, and not be particular to the individual velocities in this object, because they're all, you know, they're all rigidly joined together here. And as it turns out, the kinetic energy is actually a very simple expression in the end. It you know, the math works out so that we can actually write it down, especially in the center of mass system, as this very like handy expression. This is just actually a quadratic in the both the velocity and the angular velocity, and that's how it comes together. Coming back to the Wikipedia page, moment of inertia. Let's see for the so that you see what to expect if you go to the Wikipedia page. I think they also here they have the integrals, the volume integrals. Yeah, my good. I mean, you might. This is basically the calculations I did here. The moment of inertia is if you take the tensor and then multiply it again with the omega, then you get to the L, which is also a conserved quantity. I didn't talk about it at all. I also didn't talk about any force fields in this video, right? This is the formula that I arrived at here as well. Here they do all these tricks, maybe more explicitly. If you then if you take then this concept, you know, if you know how to compute the inertia tensor and then different kind of objects, you know, to compute the inertia tensor, you have to do this integral sum over the mass density. And if the object has extra symmetries, like, for example, I mean, the candle was already quite symmetric. Do you have anything around here? Well, if there are more symmetries around the center of mass, then it's more and more easy to compute the tensor. And also, by definition, you know, if we take another look here, by definition, we see that the inertia tensor is also a symmetric matrix, so it actually has only six independent components. So you can express then this tensor as three components: the weights, the central components, the diagonal components, and then the other three components are left for some rotation. So there's some rotation that diagonalizes the matrix. So there is some extra coordinate rotation transformation to a frame around the center of mass, in which this inertia tensor also becomes diagonal. And then depending on how this inertia values relate to each other, then you can get stronger theorems. And this is actually the approach that you get if you want to do stuff like compute spinning top, this math, which is very like a pretty object and therefore also a pretty subject to cover. If we go here at the top page of this moments of inertia thing, then you know, there's also this all this machinery. What does it say here? Flywheels, which you can analyze using also this sort of relations that we have established in this video. So here it is. It tells you how, you know, you store, in which form kinetic energy is stored, and you can make use that to reason about how you should distribute your mass, how you should design your object to have density mass functional, such that the, you know, the energy is captured and stored in a convenient way, or that it has some nice properties that you want to use in your engineering designs. Okay, so just over an hour. I know it was not my strongest go for an elaboration, but if you made it till here, comment. I hope it was interesting. Subscribe to the video, and see you in the next time.